From Hollywood, California, Columbia presents William Shakespeare's tragedy of Julius Caesar. With tonight's all-star production of Julius Caesar, the Columbia Network brings you the third in this summer's cycle of eight Shakespearean plays to be presented at the same time every Monday night during July and August. Each of these plays has been especially adapted for a full-hour radio presentation. And in each, the world's most distinguished actors will join Columbia in bringing the works of this immortal dramatist to millions of people who have never had the opportunity of enjoying them before. In tonight's performance of Julius Caesar, a stellar cast of 60 is headed by Claude Rains as Cassius, Thomas Mitchell as Brutus, Walter Abel as Casca, and Reginald Denny as Caesar. Columbia regrets to announce that Mr. Raymond Massey, who was originally cast in the role of Antony, was suddenly stricken ill this morning and will be unable to appear. Morris Ankrum, young actor and director of the New York stage, will play the part of Antony. Victor Bay, Columbia's talented young conductor, raises his baton to lead the orchestra in the musical introduction. And as the curtain rises, Conway Turrell, well-known actor of stage and screen, comes forward as narrator to set the stage for the first scene of Julius Caesar. Rome. When Rome was the world, and Caesar was the mightiest Roman, Caesar the conqueror, Caesar the lawgiver, wise Caesar, vain Caesar, brilliant Caesar, superstitious Caesar. Tomorrow he will be dead, but today he lives, and the world is his for the taking. Today is the Roman festival of the Lupercal. In a few moments, the sons of noblemen will run naked through the streets, striking all whom they meet with leather thongs. In this manner will they symbolize for the gods the purification of the city. All Rome will line the course to witness the holy race, and none more prominent than Caesar with his wife Calpurnia and his train of followers. For Caesar makes a point of appearing publicly on such occasions. He is the idol of the Republic. The servile Senate would like to make him king, but Caesar bides his time. Here he comes now through the festive crowd, a striking figure in his white toga, surrounded by the chief statesmen of the Republic, by flatterers, by sycophants, by the curious.
Calpurnia.
Caesar! Caesar speaks.
Calpurnia.
Here, my lord.
Stand you directly in Antonius' way when he doth run his course. Antonius.
Caesar, my lord.
Forget not in your speed, Antonius, to touch Calpurnia. For our elders say the baron, touched in this holy chase, shake off their sterile curse.
I shall remember. When Caesar says, do this, it is performed.
Set on, and leave no ceremony out.
Caesar!
I hear a tongue shriller than all the music, cries Caesar. Speak. Caesar is turned to hear.
Beware the Ides of March.
What man is that?
A soothsayer. Bid you beware the Ides of March.
He is a dreamer. Let us leave him. Pass.
The mighty Caesar and his train of followers move forward to the races. But two men linger behind. This one, broad of brow and thoughtful of countenance, is Brutus, statesman and scholar, scion of a noble and illustrious family, ardent believer in the Republic. That one is Cassius, dark, hawk-like, passionately patriotic, but personally envious and avaricious. Cassius speaks obliquely, with one eye on the receding figure of Caesar.
Brutus, will you go see the order of the course?
Not I.
I pray you do.
I am not gamesome.
I do lack some part of that quick spirit that is in Antony. Let me not hinder, Cassius, your desires. I leave you.
Brutus, I do observe you now of late. I have not from your eyes that gentleness and show of love as I was wont to have. You bear too stubborn and too strange a hand over your friend that loves you.
Cassius, be not deceived. If I have veiled my look, I turn the trouble of my countenance merely upon myself. Vexed I am of late with passions of some difference, conceptions only proper to myself, which give some soil perhaps to my behaviors. But let not therefore my good friends be grieved, among which number, Cassius, be you one. Nor const you any further my neglect than that poor Brutus with himself at war forgets the shows of love to other men.
Then, Brutus, I have much mistook your passion, by means whereof this breast of mine hath buried thoughts of great value, worthy cogitations. Tell me, good Brutus, can you see your face?
No, Cassius. For the eye sees not itself, but by reflection, by some other thing.
It is just. And it is very much lamented, Brutus, that you have no such mirrors as will turn your hidden worthiness into your eye, that you might see your shadow. I have heard where many of the best respect in Rome, except immortal Caesar, speaking of Brutus and groaning underneath this age's yoke, have wished that noble Brutus had his eyes.
Into what danger would you lead me, Cassius? That you'd have me seek for myself for that which is not in me. What means that shouting? I do fear the people choose Caesar for their king.
Why do you fear it? Then must I think you would not have it so?
I would not, Cassius, yet I love him well. But wherefore do you hold me here so long? What is it you would impart to me? If it be aught toward the general good, set honor in one eye and death in the other, and I will look on both indifferently. For let the gods so speed me, as I love the name of honor more than I fear death.
I know that virtue to be in you, Brutus, as well as I do know your outward favor. Well, honor is the subject of my story. I cannot tell what you and other men think of this life, but for my single self, I had as lief not be, as live to be, in awe of such a thing as I myself. I was born free as Caesar, so were you. We both have fed as well, and we can both endure the winter's cold as well as he. For once, upon a raw and gusty day, the troubled Tiber chafing with her shores, Caesar said to me, "Darest thou, Cassius, now leap in with me into this angry flood and swim to yonder point?" Upon the word, accoutred as I was, I plunged in and bade him follow. So indeed he did. The torrent roared, and we did buffet it with lusty sinews, throwing it aside and stemming it with hearts of controversy. But ere we could arrive the point proposed, Caesar cried, "Help me, Cassius, or I sink." I, as Aeneas, our great ancestor, did from the flames of Troy upon his shoulder the old Anchises bear, so from the waves of Tiber did I, the tired Caesar. And this man is now become a god, and Cassius is a wretched creature and must bend his body if Caesar, carelessly but not on him. He had a fever when he was in Spain, and when the fit was on him, I did mark how he did shake. 'Tis true, this god did shake. His coward lips did from their color fly, and that same eye whose bend doth all the world did lose his luster, I did hear him groan. Aye, and that tongue of his that bade the Romans mark him and write his speeches in their books. Alas, it cried, "Give me some drink, Titinius, as a sick girl." Ye gods, it doth amaze me. A man of such a feeble temper should so get the start of the majestic world and bear the palm alone.
Another general shout. I do believe these applauses are for some new honors that are heaped on Caesar.
Why, man, he doth bestride the narrow world like a colossus, and we petty men walk under his huge legs and peep about to find ourselves dishonorable graves. Men at some time are masters of their fates. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves that we are underlings. Brutus and Caesar. What should be in that Caesar? Why should that name be sounded more than yours? There was a Brutus once that would have brooked the eternal devil to keep his state in Rome as easily as a king.
But you do love me, I am nothing jealous. What you would work me to, I have some aim. How I have thought of this and of these times, I shall recount hereafter. for this present, I would not, so with love I might entreat you, be any further moved. What you have said, I will consider. What you have to say, I will with patience hear, and find a time both meet to hear and answer such high things.
I am glad that my weak words have struck but thus much show of fire from Brutus.
The games are done, and Caesar is returning.
As they pass by, pluck Casca by the sleeve, and he will, after his sour fashion, tell you what hath proceeded were they noted there.
I will do so. But look you, Cassius, the angry spot doth glow on Caesar's brow, and all the rest look like a chidden train.
Casca will tell us what the matter is.
Now Caesar's chariot enters the public square, hemmed in by the adoring multitude. Caesar, sharp-eyed and suspicious, has noted the withdrawal of Cassius and Brutus. He motions to his friend Antony, who paces beside the chariot as it moves slowly through the milling crowd.
Antonius!
Caesar! Let me have men about me that are fat, sleek-headed men, and such as Stephanites. Yon Cassius has a lean and hungry look. He thinks too much. Such men are dangerous.
Hear him not, Caesar. He's not dangerous. He's a noble Roman and well given.
Would he were fatter, but I fear him not. Yet if my name were liable to fear, I do not know the man I should avoid so soon as that spare Cassius. But I rather tell thee what is to be feared than what I fear. For always, I am Caesar.
Hold!
Come on my right hand, for this ear is deaf, and tell me truly what thou thinkest of him.
Brutus, you pulled me by the cloak. Would you speak with me?
Aye, Casca. Tell us what hath chanced today that Caesar looks so sad.
Why, you were with him, were you not?
I should not then ask Casca what hath chanced.
Why, there was a crown offered him, and being offered him, he put it by with the back of his hand, thus, and then the people fell a-shouting.
What was the second noise for?
Why, for that, too.
They shouted thrice. What was the last cry for?
Why, for that, too, Cassius.
Was the crown offered him twice?
Aye, that was. He put it by thrice, every time gentler than other. And at every putting by, mine honest neighbors shouted.
Who offered him the crown?
Why, Antony.
Tell us the manner of it, gentle Casca.
I can as well be hanged as tell the manner of it. It was mere foolery. I did not mark it. I saw Mark Antony offer him a crown, and as I told you, he put it by once. Then he offered it to him again. Then he put it by again. But to my thinking, he was very loath to lay his fingers off it. And then he offered it the third time. He put it the third time by, and still, as he refused it, the rabblement hooted and uttered such a deal of stinking breath because Caesar refused the crown that it had almost choked Caesar. For he swooned and fell down at it. And for mine own part, I durst not laugh for fear of opening my lips and receiving the bad air.
Soft, I pray you. What did Caesar swooned.
He fell down in the marketplace and foamed at mouth and was speechless.
Very like. He had the falling sickness.
No, Caesar had it not. But you and I, and honest Casca, we have the falling sickness.
I know not what you mean by that, but I'm sure Caesar fell down.
What said he when he came unto himself?
When he came to himself again, he said, if he had done or said anything amiss, he desired their worships to think it was his infirmity.
And after that he came thus sad away?
Ha! Aye. There was more foolery yet, if I could remember it. Fare you well.
Will you sup with me tonight, Casca?
No, I'm promised forth.
Will you dine with me tomorrow?
Aye, if I be alive and your mind whole, and your dinner worth the eating.
Good. I will expect you.
Do so. Farewell both.
What a blunt fellow this has grown to be. He was quick metal when he went to school. Good Cassius. For this time, I leave you. Tomorrow, if you will, come home to me, and I'll wait for you.
I will do so. Till then, think of the world.
Farewell.
Well, Brutus, thou art noble. Yet I see thy honorable metal may be wrought from that it is disposed. Therefore, it is meet that noble minds keep ever with their likes. For who so firm that cannot be seduced? Caesar doth bear me hard. But he loves Brutus. If I were Brutus now and he were Cassius, he should not humor me. And after this, let Caesar seat him sure, for we will shake him, or worse days endure.
Night has fallen. A storm breaks over the capital. The seven hills are stabbed with lightning. Thunder crashes and rolls unendingly above the city. Wind and stinging rain drive the superstitious Romans into their houses to cower in their beds. In the shelter of a villa stands Cassius. Another cloaked figure joins him stealthily.
Who's there?
A Roman.
Casca, by your voice.
Your ear is good.
Cassius, what night is this?
A very pleasing night to honest men.
Whoever knew the heaven's menace?
Those that have known the earth so full of faults. Now could I, Casca, name to thee a man most like this dreadful night? A man no mightier than thyself or me in personal action, yet prodigious grown and fearful as these strange eruptions are.
Caesar that you mean, is it not, Cassius?
Let it be who it is.
Indeed, they say the senators tomorrow mean to establish Caesar as a king, and he shall wear his crown by sea and land, in every place, save here in Italy.
I know where I will wear this dagger then. Cassius from bondage will deliver Cassius. Therein, ye gods, you make the weak most strong. Therein, ye gods, you tyrants to defeat. Nor stony tower, nor walls of beaten brass, nor airless dungeon, nor strong links of iron can be retentive to the strength of spirit. That part of tyranny that I do bear, I can shake off at pleasure.
So can I. So every bondman in his own hand bears the power to cancel his captivity.
And why should Caesar be a tyrant then? What trash is Rome? What rubbish and what offal when it serves for the base matter to illuminate so vile a thing as Caesar? But oh, grief. Where hast thou led me? I perhaps speak this before a willing bondman.
You speak to Casca, to such a man that is no fleering telltale. Hold my hand. Be factious for redress of all these griefs, and I will set this foot of mine as far as who goes farthest.
There's a bargain made. Now know you, Casca, I have moved already some certain of the noblest-minded Romans to undergo with me an enterprise of honorable, dangerous consequence. And I do know by this they stay for me in Pompey's porch. Come, Casca, you and I will yet ere day see Brutus at his house. Three parts of him is ours already, and the man entire, upon the next encounter, yields him ours.
It is now a few hours past midnight, and Brutus paces his orchard. The conspirators gather before Brutus' house. They go into him in a body, with Cassius at their head.
I think we are too bold upon your rest. Good morrow, Brutus. Do we trouble you?
I've been up this hour, awake all night. Know I these men that come along with you?
Yes, every man of them, and no man here but honors you. And every one doth wish you had but that opinion of yourself, which every noble Roman bears of you.
They are all welcome. Give me your hands all over. One by one.
And let us swear our resolution.
No, no, not an oath. What need we any spur but our own cause to prick us to redress?
Shall no man else be touched but only Caesar?
Casca! Well urged. I think it is not meet. Mark Antony, so well beloved of Caesar, should outlive Caesar, which to prevent, let Antony and Caesar fall together.
Our cause would seem too bloody, Caius Cassius. To cut the head off and then hack the limbs, like wrath in death and envy afterwards? Antony is but a limb of Caesar. Let us be sacrificers, not butchers, Cassius. Oh, that we could come by Caesar's spirit and not dismember Caesar. But alas, Caesar must bleed for it. And gentle friends, let's kill him boldly, not wrathfully. Let's carve him as a dish fit for the gods, not hew him as a carcass fit for hounds. And for Mark Antony, think not of him, for he can do no more than Caesar's arm when Caesar's head is off.
But it is doubtful yet whether Caesar will come forth today or no, for he is superstitious grown of late. It may be these apparent prodigies, the unaccustomed terror of this night, and the persuasion of his augurers may hold him from the capital today.
Never fear that. If he be so resolved, I can o'ersway him. Let me work, for I can give his humor the true bent, and I will bring him to the capital.
Nay, we will all of us be there to fetch him.
By the eighth hour, is that the uttermost?
Be that the uttermost, and fail not then.
The morning comes upon us. We'll leave you, Brutus.
Good gentlemen, look fresh and merrily. Let not our looks put on our purposes, but bear it as our Roman actors do, with untired spirits and formal constancy. And so, good morrow to you, everyone.
Dawn is creeping over the Roman hills. This is the 15th day of March, the Ides of March. Caesar, in his sumptuous palace, paces the marble floor with fretful feet. The awful night and the fears of his wife have played heavily upon his superstitious soul. Now there is a stir at the door, and Casca enters.
Caesar, all hail. Good morrow, worthy Caesar. I come to fetch you to the Senate House.
And you are come in very happy time to bear my greetings to the senators and tell them that I will not come today. Cannot is false. That I dare not, falser. I will not come today. Tell them so, Casca.
Most mighty Caesar, let me know some cause, lest I be laughed at when I tell them so.
The cause is in my will. I will not come. That is enough to satisfy the Senate. But for your private satisfaction, because I love you, I will let you know. Calphurnia, my wife, stays me at home. She dreamt tonight. She saw my statue, which, like a fountain with 100 spouts, did run pure blood. And many lusty Romans came smiling in it, bathed their hands in it. And these does she apply for warnings and portents and evils imminent. And on her knee hath begged that I will stay at home today.
This dream is all amiss interpreted. It was a vision fair and fortunate. Your statue spouting blood in many pipes, in which so many smiling Romans bathed, signifies that from you, great Rome, shall suck reviving blood. This, by Calpurnia's dream, is signified.
And this way have you well expounded it.
The Senate have concluded to give this day a crown to mighty Caesar. If Caesar hide himself, shall they not whisper, lo, Caesar is afraid?
Give me my robe, or I will go.
And look where Trebonius has come to fetch
Caesar.
Me.
Welcome, Trebonius. What, Brutus, are you stirred so early too? What is the o'clock?
Caesar, 'tis struck an 8.
I thank you for your pains and courtesy. See, Antony, that revels long a night, is not withstanding up. Good morrow, Antony.
So to most noble Caesar.
Bid them prepare within, and we, like friends, will straightway go together.
The Senate has gathered. Caesar stands before them at the foot of murdered Pompey's statue, surrounded by men with murder in their hearts. The time has now come for the presenting of petitions to all-powerful Caesar.
What is now amiss? That Caesar and his Senate must redress?
Most high, most mighty, and most puissant Caesar. Metellus Cimber throws before thy seat an humble heart.
I must prevent thee, Cimber. These couchings and these lowly courtesies might fire the blood of ordinary men and turn preordinance and first decree into the law of children. Thy brother, by decree, is banished.
Is there no voice more worthy than mine own to sound more sweetly in great Caesar's ear for the repealing of my banished brother?
I kiss thy hand.
But, Brutus!
But not in flattery, Caesar. Desiring thee that Publius Cimber may have an immediate freedom of repeal.
Pardon, Caesar, Caesar, pardon. As low as to thy foot doth Cassius fall to beg enfranchisement for Publius Cimber.
I could be well moved if I were as you. If I could pray to move, prayers would move me. But I am constant as the northern star. Let me a little show it, even in this, that I was constant Cimber should be banished, and constant you remain to keep him so.
Caesar!
Oh, Caesar!
Great Caesar!
Hence! Doth not Brutus, Brutus, kneel?
Speak hands for me!
Liberty!
Freedom!
True Brutus.
Ah, then, all Caesar.
Tyranny is dead! Run hence! Proclaim! Ride about the street! People and senators, be not affrighted! Blind up, stand still! Ambition's debt is paid! Stoop, Roman, stoop, and let us bathe our hands in Caesar's blood. Then walk we forth even to the marketplace, and waving our red weapons on our heads, let's all cry peace, freedom, liberty!
Stoop then and wash. How many ages hence shall this our lofty scene be acted over in states unborn and accents yet unknown?
How many times shall Caesar bleed in sport that now in Pompey's base lies alone no worthier than the dust?
How oft as that shall be, so often shall the knot of us be called the men that gave their country liberty. Here comes our family.
Mark Antony, though now we must appear bloody and cruel as by our hands, and this our pleasant act you see we do, yet see you but our hands, our hearts you see not. For your part, to you our swords have leaden points. Mark Antony.
Your voice shall be as strong as any man's in the disposing of new dignities.
Only be patient till we have appeased the multitude. Then we'll deliver to you the cause why I, that did love Caesar when I struck him, have thus proceeded.
I doubt not of your wisdom. Let each man render me his bloody hand. Friends am I with you all and love you all. Upon this hope, that you shall give me reasons why and wherein Caesar was dangerous.
Our reasons are so good and so full of good regard that were you, Antony, the son of Caesar, you should be satisfied.
That's all I seek. And am moreover suitor that I may produce his body to the marketplace. And in the pulpit as becomes a friend, speak in the order of his funeral.
You shall, Mark Antony.
Brutus, you know not what to do.
Cassius, by your pardon, I will myself into the pulpit first and show the reason of our Caesar's death. Mark Antony, here, take your Caesar's body, and you shall speak in the same pulpit whereto I am going after my speech is ended.
Be it so. I do desire no more.
Prepare the body then and follow us.
Pardon me, thou bleeding piece of earth, that I am meek and gentle with these butchers. Thou art the ruins of the noblest man that ever lived in the tide of times. Woe to the hand that shed this costly blood. Over thy wounds now do I prophesy, which like dumb mouths do ope their ruby lips to beg the voice and utterance of my tongue. A curse shall light upon the limbs of men. Domestic fury and fierce civil strife shall cumber all the parts of Italy. Blood and destruction shall but smile when they behold their infants quartered with the hands of war. All pity choked with custom of fell deeds, and Caesar's spirit, ranging for revenge, with Ate by his side, come hot from hell, shall in these confines with a monarch's voice cry havoc and let slip the dogs of war. That this foul deed shall smell above the earth with carrion men groaning for burial.
Just heard the first part of Columbia's presentation of Julius Caesar with Claude Rains, Walter Abel, and Reginald Denny. The play will continue in just a moment.